What? You know the one. You buy one, you get one free. I said you buy one, you get one free.
Two seasons and a movie. For some shows, this is the perfect length. But for the team of the Owl House, this revelation was presented halfway through the writing of the second season, just as they were setting up their next major plot lines. So, how did this affect one of Disney's most popular shows, and does it prevent it from being placed on the classic shelf next to Gargoyles, Gravity Falls, and Dog with a Blog?
I'll hunt down the most powerful wizards and steal their secrets. Wake up!
The Owl House is the creation of Dana Terrace, who was a storyboard revisionist on Gravity Falls, as well as a director on the first season of the very good DuckTales reboot series. In an interview with Collider, they state they started working on the show in 2016, working with Ricky Comita, who had previously worked as the art director for both Steven Universe and Costume Quest, to develop the look for the show. Pitching the show around to different studios, Disney eventually picked up the series, and it was announced alongside Amphibia. Dana Terrace later confirmed on Twitter that when pitching the Owl House to studios, Disney was the only one that allowed her to have a 22-minute runtime for episodes, as other studios at the time were looking for 11-minute shows instead. A pilot was produced in mid to late 2017. However, outside of a few screenshots, it hasn't been seen in its entirety, aside from those involved with its creation. The animation test for the show was leaked, however, a few months ago. The animation test didn't give anything away in the story outside of the main character's desire to learn magic, and that this little critter, called King, probably might just end up being the best character in the show. Don't ask me how I know, I've got a knack for that kind of thing. There are a few minor differences, such as the Owl House being an owl shop, King being golden rather than grey, but from the short 2-minute clip, most things that we eventually would see in the final show seem to be solidified. As for the pilot, a lot of it was actually reused for the first episode, a lying witch and a warden, with the main notable change being that instead of being able to leave at any time, like in the final show, Luce is actually trapped in the demon realm. Oh, also, Principal Bump didn't exist? In his place is Lilith, Edith's sister, and in the final series, she turns out to be the head loser of the Emperor's Coven. Ooh, I'm gonna put a curse on you, ooh. Now on every second Thursday, you'll accidentally tie your own shoelaces together, ooh. Now, don't worry folks, I didn't actually put a curse on you there, but I very well could have. So to protect yourself from a patented monotilla curse, why not hit that subscribe button and help us out? It's my curse's only weakness, but I'd also personally appreciate it. This is the second part of a two-part miniseries. My friend Mr. Turnabout covered Amphibia just a little while ago, so if you're on the lookout for another show like The Owl House, but this time with funny frogs instead, then go and check that out. There's a link in the card above and in the description. For a bit of backstory on myself, I didn't really watch many Disney Channel shows when I was younger. We had analog TV for the longest time, which meant we had four channels, not even Channel 5 since we lived in an area where it wasn't available. And the only time Disney shows were on was Saturday mornings for a couple of hours, since Disney owned a stake in GMTV, who held the franchise for ITV breakfast programs.
Oh, you know what? There's nothing stronger than the Hulk.
Aha! What a bet!
Yeah, British television has a weird history. That went off the air back in 2010, so it's been a hot minute since I'd really even thought about Disney shows, let alone watched them.
Yeah, it's just lulling you into a false sense of security, that's all.
So this was my first show there since, what, Dave the Barbarian? Emperor's New School? JoJo's Not That One Circus? Not to spoil anything, but this show kind of single-handedly started my current Disney Channel obsession. From here I went to Amphibia, Gravity Falls, Star vs. the Forces of Evil, and then on to Gargoyles. I'm currently watching DuckTales. Now, I've never had a problem with watching programming aimed at younger audiences as an adult, since at the end of the day, a good story is a good story, regardless of the audience suitability. Nor have I had a particular aversion to Disney shows. Just for some reason, Disney Channel and I never really met, which is odd considering how much I bang on about Disney parks.
Epcot's my favourite.
Which one's that?
It's the one with the giant silver ball.
Ah, yes, yes.
Heck, when Disney Plus did make it over here, the only thing I used it for was The Simpsons.
It's me, your husband, Ralph!
The Orville, and, oh shit, they got Boston Legal on here?
I do. Let's take off our clothes.
Anyway, CBBC Till I Die, Dick and Dom was the peak of British television, CITV did have the cool cartoons though, but the treatment it got post-2004 was abysmal, and ITV should be ashamed.
This is some of my best work. Really captures the shame.
Season 1 got started right at the beginning of 2020, and I think it's a bit of an odd start. The tone the first few episodes go for is a little more fantastical than the episodes following them. Although this is done in service of the overall plot, where our main character slowly realises that this fantastical world that they find themselves in actually isn't as great as they had imagined. I mention this first because it does seem to be a bit of a point of contention for some when they try to get into the show, because it handles this aspect a little too well. The first three episodes didn't turn me away so much as confuse me. I like the characters enough to want to continue. Our main character, Luz, is a bit of an outcast in society, finding herself more interested in living her life through works of fiction than applying herself in reality. Given this, it means that when she does find herself in another world, she sees it as more of a good thing. Obviously, in her case, she can leave at any point, so the stakes aren't that high, and her mother has sent her off to a summer camp, so she wasn't expecting her to be around for a few months. So I can see how this might make one more likely to stay. This means that we are introduced to the world through the eyes of an excitable teenager, which can mean that things are a bit all over the place. But I'd say if you enjoy the characters, then stick with it, as the show very quickly develops into the format it's known for. If you have an issue with the humour, then do I have news for you? The show does stop trying to be an outright comedy pretty quickly, and then I see irony that the show becomes far funnier when it's only telling the occasional joke here and there.
Boiling rains, remember?
No, let it dry. It'll be funny.
So with that asterisk out of the way, let's take it from the top. The Outhouse follows Luz Noceda, a Dominican-American girl who lives in Graysfield, a fictional town in the middle of nowhere, Connecticut. The Constitution State, the Nutmeg State, the Land of Steady Habits. Some fun facts about Connecticut. It's not spelled that way. It's famous for lobster rolls, and Zatham is Yankee Doodle. Oh, look here. The website proudly proclaims that they have the best pizza in the world. How about that? But I sympathise. I've lived in the middle of nowhere for most of my life, and as much as I enjoy it, I can kind of see why people might not. There's very little to do if you don't enjoy nature or old people.
5 minutes, yeah, go on, son. Along you go. Twat.
Well, I say I lived in the middle of nowhere as you can get in a country that's smaller than some US states. As such, she finds herself absorbed in stories of fantasy and adventure. Oh, and she also edits music to anime clips.
But I don't like any of that stuff. I like editing anime clips to music.
Hey, I just said that. If you want to see us do that exact same joke again but with a different punchline, might I recommend our Amphibia video? Honestly, it's like a choose your own adventure, and that's the kind of value you get here on Dreary Middle that you just don't get anywhere else. This all comes to a head when she brings snakes into the school to help with a book report, which seems like animal cruelty more than anything, but her mother decides to send her to reality check summer camp, and it's probably as bad as it sounds. Anyway, some Git Owl Nick's her favourite book. She follows the owl into an old house and finds herself in the town of Bonesboro, on the Boiling Isles, located in the Demon Realm. The Demon Realm is the place where all the myths humans have come from. All of them have their basis from the happenings in this very realm, including, as Ida points out, giraffes.
Giraffes?
Oh yeah, we banished those guys. A bunch of freaks.
Oh right, yeah, Ida, give us a sec, we'll get back to her in just a second. I just want to point out how little this actually ends up playing into the story, and it's mostly used for set dressing. Considering the story of the show, however, I'm not really sure how you would have fit this in, but it's called back to later. The world was inspired by the art of people such as Spanish Mexican artist Remedios Varo and Swedish painter Jan Bauer, who both specialise in creating mythical and slightly surrealist art. I love how the world itself looks, and the variety of creatures is quite a sight to behold. The inhabitants are split into two main categories: witches, which are human-like in appearance, and demons, which can range from bipedal to, There is a third category, but we'll get into that later. The art and animation in the show is consistently great. When it comes to animated shows, there is a bit of a spectrum. To get mathsy with you for a second, along the x-axis is the fluidity versus detail, and along the y-axis is the amount of Roger Craig Smiths in the show. It's just a coincidence, I promise. I picked the shows first, he just gets around. Over in the fluidity side, we have shows like Star vs. the Forces of Evil or DuckTales that prioritise having smooth animation. On the detail side, we have shows such as Amphibia or The Simpsons that prioritise having characters on model as much as possible. This isn't to say that there's a better way to do it either. I like all the shows I mentioned a lot, it's just down to the people working on the shows to find the style that works best for them. The Owl House, however, is probably the closest to the centre that I've seen in a while, and it's really quite nice to watch, with a colour palette to match too. This definitely feels how I imagined a cesspool of despair would. But in a good way. I really like all of the character designs too, and I think having no concrete way that characters should be designed was a smart move. Like, sure, witches are just humans but with pointy ears. But look! Three eyes. Face is a giant mouth. Bowl cut. Shortly after arriving in Bonesboro, Luz bumps into Ida Clawthorn. Ida is a witch, but is also known as the Owl Lady, and lives in the Owl House. Why these names? Oh buddy, I don't know, but one day, I'd like to find out. Ida is a lot of fun to be around. She constantly acts well below her age, but her practice of wild magic has made her easily the strongest witch on the Boiling Isles. She is, however, less of a parental figure and more like a big sister. Rather than keeping a watchful eye on Luz, she's sending her out to do errands or pick up rubbish and whatnot. Man, why'd the door do that? Wait, is that the owl? The owl on the owl house? Oh man, that's one more question ticked off my list. Yeah, okay, so briefly, Hooty is a character who by every metric I should dislike. Mr. Turnabout and I agreed that in any other show, this character should be cringe, and yet he's out there for us. He's the most consistently funny character, and I don't think there's a single joke of his that didn't land for me.
Sweet moves, little dude!
Ah! I always forget you're there!
I forget I'm here too!
Aside from being the door, he is also the entire house, complete with legs, which very well could be inspired by the tale of Baba Yaga. I love Hooty, but enough gushing. Look! The favourite character is arriving, Ida's housemate, King.
Try to catch me when I'm covered in grease. I'm a squirmy little fella.
According to his bio, he is loud, feisty, self-centered, and lazy. Basically, checks every box for what would be considered a dreary middle certified best character. See also Oolong, Jack Horner, and Sultai.
You motherfucker!
Cause me to be unpopular with you viewers, but I think King might not only be the best character in the show, but probably the one that goes through the most development, which for me makes him interesting. But don't think about that now, okay? We'll come back to that, don't you worry. So let's look at the main characters of the show. There is a regular supporting cast, actually quite a large supporting cast when compared to other shows, so I'll keep this brief for the time being. I'm sure we'll talk about them all with a bit more detail in due time. In season 1, we're introduced to Amity, Gus and Willow at the local school, Hexside, as well as Lilith, who is, to the Emperor, as Riker was to Picard. Willow is the first of the students Luz meets properly. She's a little shy and is often sidelined within the show in favour of the other characters. She starts off learning abomination magic, which are kind of like gloopy golems. She is pants at it, so eventually switches to plant magic, which she is not so pants at. Gus is a very talented illusionist, managing to be a couple of years higher than he should be at his age. Fascinated with human culture, he is head of the Human Appreciation Society.
It even mimics the sounds of the human ocean.
Ah, the human realm.
He knows nothing. Amity starts off as a bad girl chosen one with black nail polish and a mysteriously withdrawn attitude. She acts like she don't care, but secretly, she do. But she is foul to lose to start with, and I am talking foul. But she is very talented at abomination magics, which is no surprise considering that her father is the chief engineer at an abomination creation company. Now, Gus and Amity I like a lot. They're interesting characters. Gus wants to be accepted as one of the crew as he's one of the youngest in the school. The school doesn't seem to do years in the same way schools over here work, but rather do it based on skill.
To be in my class, you need to take a placement exam and prove that you've mastered 2 spells. Because if you don't, they'll put you in the baby class.
And Amity is just someone who hung around with the wrong kind of crowd and became shut off from the one she cared for the most. Also, she's just...
Wow, you're so unnoticeable, I almost rolled into ya!
Savage, which, going back to the list of things we like in characters, it's up there. Willow, on the other hand, is a weird character. She's in the show quite a bit, but she's not really the focus for the majority of it. It's not really until season 3 where she becomes truly important. She's kind of like the witch version of Luz, but I don't find her interesting. Not offensive or boring, just, you know, like... Gus is cool. Willow is drool. Lilith is the head of the Emperor's Coven, and the Emperor really wants Ida. So guess what Lilith is doing this season? She's one of these odd characters where it's clear that she's kind of half-arsing this specific job to the point where you kind of don't think of her as a real threat. But then she can absolutely hold her own, so I like Lilith. Again, she's not in the show that much, which is fine, but some of the raw lines she has.
Thank you, students. Good luck with puberty.
How could I not love her? Actually, on the subject of covens, you may have noticed the uniforms of colours. These represent what subject you're learning. On the Boiling Isles, it is required that you eventually join a coven. This restricts the types of magic you can use without any true benefits besides, you gotta do it, bro! Supposedly, it's to protect the user from the dangers of practicing wild magic, which... Okay, after seeing Ida, fair. Whilst at school, you're free to try out the different types, but by the time you graduate, you must pick one to stick with, or else be branded a criminal.
Can't believe that.
If this claim seems spurious to you, you wouldn't be alone. At the point in the series where this is introduced, I questioned it too. Like, Ida is weird, don't get me wrong, but, like, she seems fine.
Brain freeze!
Okay, so let's go into some of the standout episodes of the first season. The Intruder is the first episode that really sucked me into the show. It introduces how magic works in the demon realm, using a spell circle, and a magic bile sac attached to a witch's heart. This causes Luz to start to doubt whether or not she'll ever be able to do magic, Up until that point, she'd always be hopeful that Ida was about to deliver some grand lesson on the basics of magic, but kept putting it off to go root around in the rubbish. But to be told outright that Luz naturally cannot do magic gets her down, and it's interesting to watch her determination to become a witch to try to figure out the solution to this problem. King steals a potion he thinks is the source of Ida's magic in an attempt to try to cheer Luz up. But it's not for magic, it's for suppressing Ida's curse. And that's why she's the Owl Lady. I'll go into it a bit more later, but basically, the curse drains the user's ability to perform magic over time, as well as transforms the user into a beast. Luz eventually figures out that there is another way to do magic, which involves using glyphs. This is a really fun episode, and it establishes a lot of lore in one go. Although I would say don't skip the first three episodes if you can, this is the first one that feels like the Owl House to me. So you definitely do yourself a favor by giving this one a go.
Ha! Nice try!
Nah, my heart wasn't in it.
Convention goes more in depth onto how the coven system works, but it's also just a lot of fun. Luz gets frustrated with just how bloody foul Amity is being, so challenges her to a witch's duel, which of course she has no chance of winning. The fight is a good watch, and its resolution is surprisingly mature for both characters, despite how childish their mentors are being. Oh yeah, Amity's mentor is Lilith, head of the Emperor's Coven. The most prestigious one, since it allows you to practice any magic type. Hey, wait a second. Lilith turns out to be Ida's older sister, which presents this interesting dynamic. Two sisters, both practicing all magics, and with an understudy. Ida doing it the wild way, Lilith being a brown noser. Also, we are introduced to Kikimora, which is, believe it or not, voiced by Mela Lee, who is Ida's voice actor from Final Fantasy XIV, A Realm Reborn.
This is so stupid! We're the Scions of the Seventh Dawn!
Okay. It's my favourite game. I actually sat up and pointed at the screen and went, oh! Lost in Language introduces Luz to the coolest characters in the show. This kid with the mouth for a face. The episode delves a little more into the softer side of Amity, as well as sneaking around in her diary. And I guess there's a thing about baby bats too.
You've made reading far too fun, now stay out!
Something Ventured Someone Framed is the episode about Luz getting into the local school. After she got banned from entering after the events of I Was a Teenage Abomination, Gus has to sneak her in to answer questions for the Human Appreciation Society. Meanwhile, Ida thinks that perhaps maybe school might be better than me at teaching. I don't teach good.
All I know is, you taught me and I turned out just fine!
I gotta get that girl into school.
It's good to see how bad of a student Ida actually was when she was at school. This is also our first proper introduction to Matholomew. He's a minor reoccurring character that just makes me laugh. Yeah, he's a dick, that's pretty much it.
No, I want power, and I want drama, and I got one of those right now.
Don't disrespect the pizza parlor.
Escape of the Palisman delves more into the history of Albert, the Palisman on top of Ida's staff. They are more than just decorations, acting kind of like a familiar to the witch they are bonded to. Luz messes up. Could explain half the episodes, to be honest, and accidentally damages Albert. In order to prove her worth and that she really can take care of Albert, the Bat Queen challenges her to complete the most difficult tasks, which turn out to be household errands, which got a laugh out of me.
Hooray! Hooray for sport!
Sense and Insensitivity. Oh wow, a comedy episode? Oh, it's a King episode. In this episode, King eats humble pie after being rude to Luz and signing a dodgy contract to publish his book.
Spend money on my thing I wrote!
Adventures in the Elements is an important episode because it's Hooty's birthday.
It's my birthday!
No!
Enchanting Grumfrighters, okay, Adventures in the Elements is the first time that Luz and Amity properly talk after the events of Lost in Language, which is nice enough on its own, but it's also where Luz works out that the elements of the world contain the same glyphs that Luz has been using to do magic. There's a lesson in there about listening, or living with the land, or something.
I will be haunted by my actions forever! Hoot hoot!
Enchanting Gromfright. I think you would be upset if this one wasn't on the list. Not only is the twisted idea of making a student fight a monster that can transform to become your worst fears into a night of celebration a funny idea to me, but this episode contains possibly one of the most well-animated scenes in the entire show. I'm not usually one for romance in shows, but even I'll admit, it's a sweet scene, and seeing Amity's feelings for Luz develop over the series has been nice. Like, it's paced very well. How I Met Your Mother took like 9 years? But I think this feels like a good pace.
You're inadequate.
Agony of a Witch is our first proper introduction to the Emperor who rules over the Boiling Isles. Emperor Bellows has one of the greatest builds up in the series. He's consistently hinted at throughout the show, and although you never really see him, the fact that his influence touches a lot of aspects of the daily lives of the inhabitants of the Demon Realm gives you a good idea of his motives before you even meet him. I'm going to go more in depth with Bellows later, and I'm going to say a couple of treatings. But this episode has a freaking epic bridge fight and ends on a cliffhanger.
Go back to your world. This one is ours.
Which of course makes the final favourite episode, Young Blood, Old Souls, and it's a great end to the first season. We find out that it was Lilith who cursed Ida to assure her a path to the Emperor's Coven, although she believed the curse would only last a day. Ida forfeited the fight anyway, so it was all for nothing. Lilith decides to finally do the honourable thing and share the curse. But the downside is, neither of them can use magic now. We also learn of Belus' plan of the Day of Unity. Sounds fun. Oh, at some point Belus was holding Ida hostage and demanded the portal, and then Luz blew it up. We also catch a glimpse at Lilith's replacement in the Empress Coven, who may or may not become a season 2 favourite, but perhaps I've said too much. I want to return something really quickly. Yeah, I just wanted to show you that again. At the beginning of this season 1 chapter of the video, I mentioned that Luz was way too excited to be in this realm. And that is true to begin with. But quickly the honeymoon period wore off, as Luz kind of realised that the Boiling Isles really isn't a very nice place to live in. The only thing she had keeping her there was the incentive to learn magic. Now, without the portal to go back to the human realm, well, suddenly what little wonder was left is now gone. And you know what? It's kind of the opposite of Anne's journey in Amphibia. She started out having a rough time, not really liking Amphibia and its inhabitants.
The nights were the hardest.
But as the series progressed, she came more fond of the people and places. Meanwhile, Luz arrived in a very comfortable position to a world that pretty much, on the surface at least, ticked every box. But even by the end of the first series, we can see that it just is not what Luz needs. And not to spoil anything, but comparing Luz and Anne at the beginning and end of each season really is quite an interesting comparison to make. Sure, it's not uncommon in these stories about travelling to another world for the character to either love and then come to hate the world, or vice versa. I think having the easy path back to home has affected Luz's perception of the place. Being able to put up with the, to put it kindly, peculiarness of the place in order to become a witch, but being able to peace out at any time definitely warps your perception slightly. Season 1 really is a lot of fun, with a good amount of world building, character development, and memorable scenes. I think it's also a really natural progression from doing fairly self-contained stories in order to establish the world, into doing more continued storylines with the setting up of Ida's curse, Luz's new task of finding a way home, and Emperor Belus' plan. It finds that nice balance of giving you enough to be satisfied, but not give you too much so that you want to come back for more. It's really well written and a fantastic first season. So let's see what's in store for season 2.
Don't you talk about my mother!
Season 2 pretty much picks up where Season 1 left off. However, now there are 3 established main goals. The threads of the story now pops up more often, and with a set date for the endpoint of this story arc being the Day of Unity, there is this sense of urgency that runs throughout the course of the series, thus giving the season the title of All Killer, No Filler. Now, I really like Season 1, but I love Season 2. Most complaints that I've heard people have for the first season are pretty much ironed out with the second season. The jokes land better. The character interactions are more interesting. Hooty's in it more. I'd argue that there are no bad episodes in this season, much like The Simpsons Season 7.
I can't remember when I've heard a funnier anecdote. Okay, now you tell one.
Season 3 of Home Movies.
Kitty is upset. Meow.
And Season 1 of Severance. 2 more characters rise to prominence in this season too. Emperor Belus and the Golden Guard. Emperor Belus, as touched on last season, is not really the most active of villains. Now, I don't mean this in a negative way, but when you look at the history of Disney villains, they often are held in very high regard, often more so than heroes. Come on, you're telling me you like Hercules more than Hades? Adam over Gaston? Basil over Ratigan? Actually, that last one is the hardest one for me, because I like both nearly as much as each other. But Belus, on the other hand, isn't that good of a villain in the traditional sense, and I think that really helps the story, because he doesn't care about the characters. Anything he does is purely for theatre. His plan is already in motion, so he doesn't really have to do anything but wait. He's going to antagonise the characters, sure, but he's not a force that's seen in every episode. His first appearance in the show is in the second to last episode of season 1, and although he does appear in most episodes this season, sometimes it's just in the background, on a video or something. Instead, his underlings take on a bit more of a prominent role this season, most notably of which is the Golden Guard. Guard starts off as a little too loyal to Belus, like he's always got something to prove, except this definitely reeks of fear. As the series progresses, it's interesting to watch how this perfect guard, who's actually good at his job, start to falter as he notices that he's not like the others of his age. He starts running into Luz more and eventually reveals his name to be Hunter. This sort of starts an internal conflict between whether or not the Emperor's Coven is where he really wants to be. Now, I really like Hunter, and not to be throwing any shade on any of the characters seen so far, but he's probably just behind King and Ida on my favourites list. Sorry, Luz. Luz also starts to learn about Philip Witterbane, the last human to visit the Boiling Isles. She is told about the existence of his diary from Eda's mother, and although his diary was eaten by Ann Mouse, this mouse digests the knowledge and will display it when it's fit and proper to do so. Seems a little inconvenient, but sure. Big King reveals too. Eventually he finds out that he is a titan, like the very one the characters have been living on, but more on that later. Okay, so that's enough of that. Let's talk favourite episode, shall we? Separate Tides is just a fun episode, and I'm not defending my choice on this one at all. It gives you a quick update on what's happened in the months since the end of the first season, gives us a better introduction to the Golden Guard, and is just a lot of fun watching the characters become bounty hunters.
Sup.
Echoes of the Past is the first episode we've really had that properly explores King's past. We know next to nothing about him, and to finally find out where he came from is a good first step, although we don't really find out too much about him here. I do want to point something out though. What Eda did, and please excuse my language here, but it was fucked. Like, I get playing make-believe with a child as part of playtime, but to keep this lie going for 8 years is just not fair. Sure, it could be argued that, well, maybe he should have caught on, but you tell a person for their entire life that they're one thing, and they're actually another? Look, Eda, I'm going to give you a quick film recommendation, okay? Go and watch The Truman Show, okay? And then come back and think about what you've done. Also, Lilith and Hooty are rude this episode too. Don't think you're getting off that easily.
Special delivery!
Pain!
Oh, Hooty, I could never stay mad at you.
Now, Jean-Luc.
Hunting Palisman is where I'd say we really start to get to know the Golden Guard, who in this episode reveals himself to be Hunter. The episode starts off with a Palisman adoption day, which is a good idea. Why make something new when you can give a home to someone who needs one? Luz can't decide what she wants to be, and so no Palisman steps forward to be her familiar. Then Hunter steals them. Everbellos needs their green life juice for himself, you see. This hand dragon is cool. I like it. It's the most Boiling Isles thing we've seen so far. I really like this episode, and although you know Hunter is going to turn on Luz at the end, no matter how pally he gets with her, you definitely see him start to question a few things, and when he does eventually return to the castle, he's very much a changed man. The ending scene all but confirms it too. Is Hunter a bad person? Well, no, he's just been raised in a bad environment. He does seem to really care about his Uncle Bellows, but also fear him at the same time. Eda's Requiem gives us the formal introduction to Rain Whispers, who is now head of the Bard Coven? Actually, they're a mole for the resistance working to take down the Emperor from the inside. But the loser gets caught, like, straight away. It's also an opportunity to delve deeper into Eda's past, which, well, I'm with Luz on this one. I want to know more. The B-plot of the episode is about how Eda is worried that everyone is going to leave her, just as she was getting attached to them, which ends up potentially saving her life after Rain notices that sacrificing themselves when Eda has a family is probably a silly idea.
Eda, do you have kids? But they're not mine.
We also learn that Eda's curse corrupts magic, which surely will become useful later. This is a sweet episode all round, and it had me leaving and then ugly crying. It didn't, but it was too good not to. I forget it. Knock, knock, knocking on Hootie's door. Are you surprised? No! Not only is this an episode with a lot of Hooty and King in it, you also get hints that King might not be a demon after all, after not fitting into one of the three very well-defined categories of demon. Eda has started to make peace with her curse, which has led to her being able to meet the curse halfway and transform into a harpy creature. This black and white scene is also very visually striking too. And finally, Hooty helps Amity and Luz finally get together. This is probably one of my favourite episodes in the entire series, and before you mention it, the stones aren't charged in the box, so they can't use it to get home. Yesterday's lie answers the question of what's been going on back in Connecticut while Luz has been away.
You!
And the answer is, actually not a lot. Luz's mum, Camila, wasn't worried about Luz not being home because she had a doppelganger to take her place. Said doppelganger, V, took advantage of Luz arriving in the demon realm for a chance to have a real family. Is it cheesy? Sure. But it's nice to have a story where the family isn't suffering because of an absence of a member. And although Camila desperately wants Luz home, making a promise never to return to the demon realm should she make her way back home, she does take good care of V going forward. You know, finders keepers, lose one child, find another. It's like that film, Odd Life of Timothy Green, or something. No wait, they didn't have a kid, did they? You know, that's the same house as Halloween 2, right? No, not that Halloween 2. Say what you will about Rob Zombie. V is a basilisk. They're shape-shifting magic eaters, which Bellows was breeding back from extinction in order to study how they absorbed magic. Additionally, this episode also foreshadows two brothers being abducted from Gracefield. You should know who one of them is, but I'm kind of shocked that Philip didn't even put that anywhere in his diary, like, "My name is Philip. I am 30 years old from Gracefield." I do that with all my things. That way, I know they're mine. Hollow Mind is the second in your brain episode, and it's easy to kind of see this one as an info dump, but it's clever about it. It shows Bellows' rise to power, as well as presenting Hunter as being a Grimwalker, which is sort of like a clone, but
they come from the ground.
This seems cursed. It also reveals that Philip Witterbane and Oprah Bellows, same bloody person, can you believe it? I don't mean to come off as haha. Aren't I smart for predicting where the kid show was going?
Ha, you're stupid.
But any chance to act smug? Honestly, there was only one person who it could be. The way Philip spoke to Luz and Lilith should have been enough to give it away alone. But the show is clever about it too. Props to casting for finding an actor to play the younger character in a way that sounds natural. In this episode, you get to hear both Alex Lawther and Matthew Rhys play the younger and older version of the character side by side, and it sounds natural.
Perhaps we were destined to meet.
It would have been really easy to just ask Mr. Rhys to try to sound younger. Although a small part of me, specifically the left bicep, don't worry, it's a very small part, wants to say it was because they wanted to keep it harder to guess who Bellows really was. Either way, I like these performances. Both of them.
In the movie of your life, who would play you? Maggie Smith.
Quickly, this episode also explains how he's been able to shapeshift too. Somehow snorting palisman green can let you do that, which is wild to be honest. Labyrinth Runners is a bit of a weird one to have this late into the season, but it's still a good episode. Of course, we get the big plot point that Bellows is really starting to crack down on Covenant's witches. Which is obviously a little suspicious, because most of them are children. Of course, if there was any doubt that the Day of Unity might not be something that is going to end happily for the citizens of the Boiling Isles, then this surely would cast those aside. We also see Hunter for the first time since Hollow Mine, to find that he's been camping inside Hexside. Hunter officially makes friends with Gus, Amity, and Willow. Clouds on the Horizon and King's Tide round out the season with a few Batista bombs of knowledge. The Day of Unity is here, and it's your problem, my friend. With everyone gathering at the site in preparation for the eclipse, it's up to the covens against the throne to try to stop it. The plan is quite simple. Established already is that Aedas curse corrupts magic, so just sneak her in. Easy. Meanwhile, Luz, Gus, Hunter, Willow and King are attempting to rescue Amity, who has been grounded because she told her mum about the Day of Unity. Of course, besides the scene, we also get our first proper conversation with Alador as he talks with King. I like Alador. He's a smart man who got too wrapped up in his wife's vision. He put aside his doubts on the Emperor's plans for the advancement of their company. However, after listening to what the people around him are telling him, he realizes that perhaps the little inklings he had in his head were right all along. Aeda and Rain go over the plan once more. Aeda will get a bard sigil and then be disguised as Rain. The ceremony starts and it's going okay. Kikimora kidnaps Luz, believing her to be Hunter, which is awesome. Now watch as this leads to the best line in the entire show.
I just want to help.
You want to help? Go find a hole to wither away in.
Breathtaking. Bellows has some of the best lines in the show, and they're all from this episode.
Or, if you're looking for a new right hand...
Have you as my right hand? I'd sooner cut off my whole arm.
I would give you a little kissy, but you made a goo. Which scares me. Not the cream egg goo either. I like that. If you're made out of cream egg goo, that probably would scare me as well.
I like it with chips.
The other coven heads realise that there are traitors among them and sort them out. I gather the coven heads basically blindly trust the Emperor, but this whole thing seems evil. You saw him melt, like, you'd be suspicious of that, surely.
The other coven heads think they're going to be royalty after today.
Oh, they said you'd be royalty. All right, fair. Luz and Bellows fight. The others join in while King and Kikimora retrieve the collector's tablet. Kikimora was feeling a little bit upset with the whole go die in a ditch thing. You should probably get over that, you baby. So I've not really touched on the collector that much, because if Bellows is in the background of the entire show, then the collector is in the background of his scenes. Literally, in some cases. They're the one who taught Bellows pretty much everything he knows, assuming the collector part is a job title rather than a name. Hoarding things is their speciality. I like the collector. In concept, they're fucking scary, and don't seem to understand the consequences of their actions, or the power that they wield. But on the other hand, they unironically say pizza bagels.
Pizza bagels!
Having an all-powerful child is a great idea for a villain. The Twilight Zone and Star Trek both knew this back in the 60s, and it was scary then, and it's scary now. I say all-powerful, the Collector does have a foil in the form of Titans. The Collector makes reference to King being one, and how King's father might have been the one to bring them down and trap them in the tablet. Oh boy, With all this, King decides he needs to protect his friends, so he forces them through the portal that Bellows built into the human realm. It's a great set of episodes, and I'm glad it got a two-parter. Understandably, this does leave a lot to wrap up. This does feel like something that would happen at the end of a second act, but the L House's newly shortened third act is going to wrap up a lot. If we look at the plot points established over the season, it's going to be no small task to wrap this all up neatly. There are going to be loose ends. Now, I don't have a problem with the story not being 100% wrapped up, but when you easily have enough content to stretch to another season, potentially two, it's going to be tough to cover all of that in three double-length episodes. So there are a few questions we have left. Ida and Lilith still can't do magic. The curse that they have is still present. Titans in general. Where do they come from? Where do they go? How are they connected to the Collector? How big is King going to get? Although Luz found a way back to the human realm, she now has companions. Luz's talisman hasn't hatched yet. Who is the Collector? What's going to happen to the inhabitants of the demon realm? If they are successful in stopping the Collector, how are they going to clean up afterwards? Bellows clearly isn't dead, so what's happening there? The Coven Heads also aren't just going to disappear, what about them? And most importantly, what the fuck is Hooty? Okay, well, let's see how it all turns out.
Hey Mom, I'm back.
Season 3 is in the unique position where it can be considered a movie. All three episodes flow from one to the next with no gaps and comes to about 2.5 hours in length. Of course, squeezing an entire season's worth of plot points into that length of time is going to be tricky. When you look at TV films that came after cancellations, such as Serenity, Peacekeeper Wars, and Deadwood, 13 years later, they all seem to have a kind of, okay, we gotta get a move on feel. Serenity, for example, reveals where all the Reavers came from, and then kills half the cast off. The L House suffers from this a bit, however, it follows on from the previous season, was released episodically over a period of about 6 months, and wasn't released in theatres, which means that it avoids the number one biggest problem with films based on TV shows. Explaining what we already know. Star Trek Generations was like, now this is Kirk, and he is old, so he died. And this is Picard, and he's old, but not too old as to have died. His fate is far worse. When in about 20 years, he's gonna get knocked on his ass in an explosion, and he's gonna fall. Yeah, I collect rocks in my spare time. How about you? Oh, really? Just the three? Sorry, they're back. Yeah, I'll ring you in a bit, okay? Cheers. Anyway, Season 3 begins immediately where Season 2 left off. Our characters have arrived from the demon realm and now must adjust to life over here in the human realm. We get a short montage of what the characters get up to. It's summer by the start and late October by the end, so these characters were here for a while. We see scenes of them attempting to create portals, Luz introducing her mum to Amity, and Gus stealing the spotlight. This isn't your moment, man, get out of here! As well as a few more scenes showing what probably would have been whole episodes had this been a full season. Like the characters having to work out that they can't show their ears around the human realm, which actually was an entire episode in Amphibia and a plot point in a few Star Trek episodes and movies. This is a bit of a tangent, but this scene I really like.
Mum, why aren't you mad at me?
It's a sweet scene. I've had a moment like this with my dad before, and I respect a man to the end of the earth. Shout out to my dad. He doesn't watch these videos, so I can get away with that.
I love you, Dad.
They eventually find a puzzle under the old shack and decide to surprise Luz as a thank you for taking them in by solving the puzzle. This takes them all over town to try to find answers to the clues and... Wait a minute. What a chiseled schnoz. Anyway, they eventually find out that it's a map of where a stash of Titan's blood may be hidden. Meanwhile, Luz is cooking up a surprise of her own. She's planning on never returning to the Boiling Isles and wants to stay here. Her reasoning is that, aside from promising her mum that she'd never return, that she feels responsible for all of this happening. She was the one that helped Philip find the Collector, effectively setting this whole thing in motion. She feels too that a lot of the strife that the characters encountered over the course of the series is entirely her fault. I get it. As someone who has this wonderful gift called overthinking, it can start to warp your sense of reality just a little bit. But from an outsider looking in, this seems like an overreaction. And jumping ahead a bit, everyone seems to agree, including Camila. Hunter also thinks that he saw Bellos, which he probably did. But his body is made from goo, so there is a non-zero chance that a little splashed on you when the Collector did that.
Hunter, what's wrong?
Bellos.
All right, Bellos. What's about to happen should be relatively painless, if you just do what we say.
That's right. So come out with your hands behind your creepy dumb head.
Oh wow, cool antlers, bro. It's Halloween time, and finally the two surprises will be delivered. After this spooky ride, wow.
Two orphaned brothers arrive in Gravesfield. Their names? Philip and Caleb.
Oh no.
Maybe Philip saved Caleb, and they went on to lead peaceful lives. Or maybe he's still chasing his brother, caught in a cycle of horror and strife!
Okay, well, that was an experience for all involved. Hunter is a clone of Philip's older brother, Caleb, which is a pseudonym Hunter used when he was recruiting people at the Flyer Derby. Flapjack, his palisman, was the one who suggested he use that name, and it's hinted at that Flapjack is connected to Evelyn, who was supposedly the witch that ended up bringing Philip and Caleb to the demon realm. After seeing this, Hunter decides to spoil the surprise and orders Flapjack to steal the puzzle so they can go and find the blood. Wait, orders?
There!
Oh, there he goes. Luz realizes that her glyphs are working again, which means that the Titan's blood must be nearby. Bellows reveals that he is in control now of Hunter, and this leads to an incredibly well-animated fight scene.
Hey Bellows, remember me?
No, no!
Which Bellows sort of wins? I mean, he separates from Hunter, kills Flapjack, and makes a portal back to the demon realm, you know? The team decide to follow him in, including Luz's mum. I really like this first episode. It's kind of divisive online, with some people thinking they spend too much time on Earth, some thinking they don't spend enough, a few lamenting that we don't see enough of the Boiling Isles in it. Honestly, I'm fine with it. This is Luz's story, and she's trapped in the human realm. Sure, a matter of months pass in this episode, but outside of bumming around, what really could we see? There's something that they need to do, and so they're going to do it. Obviously, the montage doesn't make up for missing out on essential plot, but when placed in this impossible position of trying to complete the story in a time limit without making it impossibly dense, this was the best way to do it. Get all the typical, we're in a new place, stuff out of the way in a montage, and then focus on the main meat and potatoes. That being, how do we get back? There's no way that you'd please everybody, but you pleased me, and since I'm the voice you're listening to right now, that's all that matters. Episode 2 starts off where King's Tide ends. We see what happens in the moment after Luz's blast is through the door.
Glad that wasn't us.
The Collector immediately starts terraforming the world. We see that they also built themselves a nice house. Huh, wonder what they're gonna decorate it with. Oh, okay. Skipping forward a bit until the gang arrives, and Luz gets stuck behind in the space between realms, when she sees a little critter running around. But before she can investigate, she's pulled through into the demon realm. A quick visit to the outhouse is in order, and the place has been ransacked. Camila confides in Gus and Willow. She's worried about the decision Luz is planning on making.
She's so determined to make herself sad, and I don't know how to help.
That's such a good line, and it's nice to see that Camila, after spending time with the witches, has kind of reevaluated why Luz decided to stay in the demon realm. Emotional maturity. Camila asks Willow how she's feeling, noticing that she's looking a bit distressed. Willow says she's fine. I question this. I understand that it can be hard to talk to people about things sometimes. Trust me, I get it, but the response seems a bit weird.
Don't worry about me. You heard what Gus said. I'm the reliable one.
If there's a complaint I have for this episode, this is it. Like, the plot point of Willow being stressed seems like it's put in just for the payoff later, and I do get who watches the watchers, but this was the most easily avoidable problem. You've lived with Camila for a few months. Take care of yourself. Do it for your friend's sake. Bonesbury's looking good this time of year. Well, that was unsettling. Luz and friends bump into Matt, Sarah, and Barkus.
Has Thalamuel been your last name this whole time?
Yeah, can't you read the subtitles? Bellows is around looking for a new body, as the one he currently has decided that being solid is not worth it. He is confronted by a vision of Caleb, who's just staring at him.
Don't mock me.
Nah, he's just staring at you. He does eventually find an unfinished Grimwalker and uses that to heal his body. The Collector and King return to the castle. Odalia, being the brown nose as she is trying to convince the Collector to give her a higher position of power. The Collector is having none of it and just orders them to clean up. Ah, bedtime. My favourite part of the day. And of course, no bedtime would be complete without a story. Stories are fabulous. Stories are fun. This gives a little more of an insight into who the Collector and their kind truly are. The Collector seem to be exactly that. They collect, except instead of collecting objects, they collect beings, presumably to keep some sort of record of life across the universe. A noble cause, one might be tempted to say, if it wasn't for the fact that they A. kidnap you and freeze you against your will, B. if you resist, they proceed to commit genocide. This is basically the next level bug on a corkboard, with the side helping of, if you sting me, I'm torching your house. This also raises an additional question. Are you still aware in the puppet state? In the next scene, we see Hooty talk to Lilith and Ida.
Sequestered in a darkness like unto death, the dulcet tones of an angel wakes me. Be it you?
Is that a fluke because of how powerful Hooty is? Or are you always awake in there? If so, not happy about that arrangement at all. Luz and the gang arrive at Hexside, which is now entirely run by the students, and it's not going so well. Because the school is being run by Busher and her first in command, Kikimora,
and her trusted guards, Mickey.
Yeah, whatever. Luz presents her plan to save the day, and Busher rejects it. So they plan to do it on their own. The easiest way in is to teleport into the Titan's head, just as Philip did. So they dig around in Luz's memories to find the spell.
I'm gonna assume those are clean.
We don't think so.
Whilst waiting, Willow presents a picture of Hunter at the Flyer Derby, which appears to make Hunter upset. Which makes Willow upset. There she goes.
I've known you were a Grimwalker since the day of Unity. I was waiting for you to bring it up yourself, but...
Gus and Hunter follow her, leaving the others alone in the room. Both groups get ambushed, which causes Loser's group to get thrown into the pit. After getting a good rest, Bellows is back up and around. Okay, maybe that wasn't a good rest at all. So he's off to find a new body. I guess he can use anything as a body, so decides to inhabit Reigns. He then decides to go and whisper, words of corruption into the ear of the Collector. If I was a Collector, I would have just told him to sling his hook. Back at Hexside, Matt and Amity take on Busher, while Luz and Camila take on Kikimora. After Busher opens up about why she's acting the way she is towards Amity, they convince her to let them try to save everyone, and she agrees.
I've got it all under control.
Kikimora isn't so easy. This causes Luz to start to doubt herself, and that once again, she's messed up. But messing up is a factor of life, and this is something that Camila knows only too well. This includes her biggest mistake, pushing Luz to be something she wasn't, which in turn was the true root cause of this whole thing. Luz finally realizes that that's what she wants, more than anything, to be understood. This causes her talisman to finally start to hatch, and creates a staff.
Luz has a staff.
Why does that make me nervous?
Busher has rallied the troops to tackle Kikimora, allowing for Luz and the gang to escape and deploy the teleporting spell, taking them into the head of the Titan. Back to Bellow's old throne room, which is looking a little worse for wear. Luz introduces her friends to the Finnish palisman, Stringbean, who is a shape-shifting snake. Because she wants to be understood, fam! People are impressed. I would have been too, but my friend had just sent me this funny meme. Let me just get it up for you.
I think I want to play a new game.
Okay, Monotilla, hold it together. Don't go for the obvious. And that's the end of the second episode. Much like the Two Towers, it very much is the second act, and is used mostly for setting up the plot points that are going to be covered in the next episode. It is a good episode for sure, but definitely is more chill than the previous one. There's no huge action set pieces like the first episode, and no major bombshells, but it was a good opportunity to flesh out the other plot points involving King, Ida, and the Collector. Before going on to the next episode, I just want to take this opportunity to say that the gap between the second and third episode was long. Technically, it was shorter than the gap between the first and second, 77 days as opposed to 98, but you know when you'll want something? Yeah, that. Mr. Turnabout made the smart decision to wait until all three episodes were out before watching them. I'm stupid, so I didn't do that. The final episode begins with our characters being abducted by the Collector, before quickly losing consciousness. Luz briefly finds herself in the space between realms again, and is being told to wake up. So, Luz, King, and Ida separately appear to be trapped in their own nightmare realms. King and Ida as punishment for trying to go against the Collector, and Luz for being a prior co-conspirator. Nightmare realm is what we're here for. This also answers the question of, are you conscious when you're a puppet? And the answer seems to be yes, which I am 100% not a fan of. No, thank you. After getting everybody out of their respective spook zones, Luz gets to see the Collector more for what they really are. A child. They don't understand what they're doing and how it might be affecting those who they do it to. The Collector goes a bit more into their past, revealing that they are the youngest of their kind and were sent out by the elders to investigate the Titans, as they were a race who were able to effectively cancel out their magic. Well, this just won't do, will it? A beef started between the Titans and Collectors. The Titans lost badly, with King being the only remaining Titan. The Collector got banished to the space between realms, and the rest of the Collector's kind probably fucked off when they had the chance. This would make the Collector themselves hundreds of years old. Perhaps maybe that's why they don't understand the concept of mortality. I don't think it's explicitly stated whether or not they are immortal or just old geezers, but regardless, the lifetime of a human is but a mere blink to this species. The Collectors are somewhat reminiscent of the Q from Star Trek, a species who were basically above everything else. They could travel between dimensions and worlds with the snap of a finger. They had the ability to do pretty much anything. Create, destroy, transmogrify, you name it, they could do it. But being a Q is fundamentally boring, because you can do anything. It means that you can do anything, and as such, the Q would find themselves meddling in the affairs of other species, even being the direct cause of several wars throughout the universe.
One of his self-destructive stunts created a misunderstanding which ignited the 100-year war between the Romulans and the Vulcans.
This was revealed in a Star Trek Voyager episode known as Death Wish, where a Q, who later named himself Quinn, became almost horrified at his own existence and immortality, that he wished for it to be ended.
When life has become futile, meaningless, unendurable, it must be allowed to end.
It's a fantastic episode and one of my favourites, so if you're in the mood to see a collector-like being struggle with their existence, I absolutely would recommend this episode if you haven't seen it already. But that's getting a bit too existentially for the intended audience of the Owl House, so let's get back on track. Oh goodness, is she still alive in there? This has been the opposite of avoiding the existential stuff. Belos, who has been inhabiting Rain's body, has been finding it hard to retain control of it. This fight causes the puppet effect to wear off. Oh, for you, that is some good news. Eventually, they both make it to the throne room, where it becomes clear that Belos wants to merge with the heart of the Titan, which is still beating. Rain attempts to stop Belos with a protective shield around the heart, but is unsuccessful. This causes Belos to be spread around the body of the Titan and gaining control of it. When you think of plans that are, and to use the term in its original definition, epic, controlling the island you live on has to be up there in terms of the maddest shit you've ever seen, right? Oh good. Amity has been able to wake herself and the others up, but uh-oh, where's Luz? Well, she's off showing the Collector how she became friends with Ida and King, in an attempt to help them understand that you can't just force things to be the way you want them, because it's never the same as going out and letting things happen naturally on their own. Also, you know, be kind and other people will like you, you attract more flies with honey, and you don't win friends with salad. Oh look, a giant Belos. Go on, little fella, go and use all the knowledge you've learned so far.
What is he doing?
I get it now. You just need kindness and forgiveness, huh?
No!
Finally, this gives the Collector a reality check on the sanctity of life. For mere losers such as you and me, life is merely the journey to the great beyond, the destination you cannot return from. And that's something the Collector is finally learning for themselves. Yes, whilst it is true that they weren't happy at the death of the Titans, it would be fair to say that they didn't have the full perspective on what exactly it meant to be a friend rather than just a plaything. This of course makes Ida and King go beast mode, who begin to attack Big Belos. Beast mode is something we respect over here. We play Sonic Unleashed and had one hell of a time with it too, you hear? We love King. Yes. Luz is not dead. Well, she might be dead. It's hard to say. Anyway, she's here in the space between realms again, and is confronted by the one and only Titan. King's father, no less. Well, not him, he's still out there as the island. This is, I guess you could say, his soul or spirit, which means that the body is very much still alive, but there's no one at home. The Titan's spirit is, however, not immune to the goings-on of the physical body, and as such is succumbing to the influence of Belos with his green goo. He donates the last of his powers to Luz, gives her a little message to give to King, before Luz is airlifted out of here. Ida and King continue to fight Belos and, losing. Speaking of losing, the Collector. He's lost his powers, and the special source that took over the Titan is having an effect on the Collector, which means that for the first time in their life, they feel mortal. And it doesn't feel good. For the first time in their life, they feel fear. This reminds me of another Star Trek episode, Deja Q, from The Next Generation, where Q is stripped of his powers and forced to live as a human.
Red alert.
I swear I'm not turning into Mike Soklasa, I just like Q and the Collector.
The life was oozing out of me. I lost consciousness.
You fell asleep.
Oh, terrifying.
Deja Q is also an awesome episode, so check it out. You know what? Pause the video now. Go away and watch Star Trek The Next Generation, Deep Space Nine, and Voyager. It's only, what, 517 episodes?
My God.
Shields!
See you in 2 weeks.
Man, have you looked in a mirror lately?
Oh my God, what was that?
I'm back!
Oh, Oh, it's Ujima Flip, innit? Nah, it's cool. The Titan's magic probably wouldn't have done this if it was anyone else. It's fully within reasonability to believe that they did this so that Luz could have their superpower transformation moment. As a treat, a very well animated scene of Luz, King, and Ida playing around with the new powers. It looks to be a merging of pretty much everything we've seen in the series so far. It does also show the extent of the damage Belos' goo has done to the place. Fighting the island, holy moly. But I think that might have been a bit too over the top, so why make it hard for yourself? Take on the heart itself. In the heart chamber, ooh, did you like what I did there? Yeah, in the heart chamber, Rain is still in there, Lamau. And with Luz's power starting to wane, the team decide to get a wiggle on. Big props for this also for not being a typical big fight scene. The sheer rawness of ripping Belos off the heart is just amazing. I am the kind of person who preferred Dragon Ball when there weren't lasers in it. So to have this rather detailed scene of our main character ripping our villain out with the skin peeling and shredding is really cool. I know Belos is made from goo, but if this was skin and bloody, your eyes would bug out of your head and say, oh my god. But it's green, so we're Gucci. The remnants of Belos start fading away as his influence fades. Even the goo on the collector is going away. Now watch as the collector flinches. Wow, you lose your powers and suddenly you get a whole new perspective on life. Anyway, the boiling rains melt Belos, and holy shit, they just jump on his head! Ledges! And that's pretty much it. The remaining 10 minutes of the episode is an extended epilogue. The best way to describe it is showing that not everything was fixed overnight. The rebuild itself took nearly 4 years, and in that time, a lot of the characters have moved on. Hunter is a palisman carver, Lilith, Matt and Kikimora helping to build new buildings, Alador is experimenting with sigil removal, Gus is now a lecturer, Ida has accidentally stumbled out the headmaster's office, and most importantly, lanky boy King. The gang had been preparing for a party for Luz, who not only has been helping with the rebuild effort, but is also about to start studying at the University of Wild Magic. King is also starting to develop his own glyph system as he continues to grow. Finally, the collector passes by on their travels throughout the universe, which gives the cast just enough time to say goodbye. And that's it. That's how the Owl House ends. With the good ending. With that, I think it's time to reflect on Season 3. Yes, I've said a lot so far, but I can always say just a little bit more. As mentioned earlier, treating this as a film or TV movie, it gets so much right where others went wrong. I also think that the three episodes hold up both individually as well as together. But it is also without a shadow of a doubt that this isn't the creator's original intention for this season, and not even every question I posed at the end of Season 2 got answered. And worst of all, Hooty got one line over the entire season, which is a bloody crime. Okay, to put aside my jokes for a second, I do actually appreciate just how light on humour this final season was. You have a world that's in trouble and a main character who blames herself for everything that's happened. It would have felt out of place to be cracking jokes the entire time. To clarify another thing, Hooty legitimately is one of my favourite characters in the show. Much to the chagrin of my friends, I tend to rate characters based on the percentage of time I enjoy their presence on screen. Obviously there is a bottom limit to this, like I'm not going to be like, oh, I enjoyed this passerby the most because they had one line and I liked it. It has to be at least in the supporting cast. Like, my favourite character in Dragon Ball is Oolong, despite the fact that he's only really relevant in the show for 9 episodes over the show's 153 episode run. He really is the life of the party, and I immediately noticed his absence. However, the choice not to include one of my favourite characters is also fine. Hooty is a gag character, and I think trying to mould him into something he's not would have been dishonest to the character. To follow on from that too, it could have been very easy to pack the episodes full of fanservice. Sure, there are a few member berries around, and of course the big fight had to end in the same way the series began, but the writers instead were focused on making the story as good as it possibly could have been. So was it good? Yes, I came away completely and utterly satisfied. I think that it's a good season, not just to the Owl House, but of television.
Yeah, that's good that.
But I would say that it's still probably my least favourite of the three, just simply because of how much good stuff is in the other two seasons. It's not a fair fight, but if it's anything, I do think that the epilogue is the perfect way to end the series. We see enough to get an idea of what happened next without explicitly committing to anything. Every character is accounted for, but without going into too much detail. Just in case you're wondering, the epilogue is just shy of a quarter of the runtime of the final episode, so it is pretty decent in length. So, to conclude, The Owl House is my favourite Disney show. Yes, its ending is understandably rushed, the team had to find a way of reducing what easily could have been an entire season or more's worth of material down into a movie, but I was satisfied with the ending we got. And as I mentioned before, Serenity and Beastkeeper Wars didn't really scratch that same itch for me. I was asked by a friend if I would take a Season 4 or a mulligan on Season 3 if everybody involved would be up for it, and I didn't want to answer it until I'd seen the final episode, but you know what? No, the show has had its time, and although many have felt it was robbed somewhat of its full potential, myself included, I think it's fine as it is. I love the characters, I love the world, I love pretty much everything about the show, so why change it? Don't misunderstand me, if there were to be a continuation of the show, I'd absolutely check it out in a heartbeat. But also, and I would never want to bother the creator of anything anyway, as it's their decision on what they want to do, but I'm not going to be begging anybody for anything. Are there things I would have preferred to have seen? Sure. Is the show perfect? Next to nothing is. Am I more than satisfied with what we have? Absolutely. For context, Severance was the best show I watched in 2022, and I was actually a little disappointed to hear it was getting a second season. Not to spoil anything, but I think the ending of season 1 is so perfect that I didn't feel like it needed a continuation. I personally find it very easy to put something down once it's done, rather than continuing it on until it's no longer fun anymore. Leave them wanting more is one of the truest things anybody has ever said about anything. And this applies here to The Owl House too. It absolutely has earned a spot on the classic shelf, and you know what? Everybody who worked on the show should be proud with the finished result, regardless of how they feel about how it turned out. It's a magical show.